the pulpit of the First Baptist Church of Dallas, Texas, this is Pathway to Victory with Dr. Robert Jeffress.
Hi, I'm Robert Jeffress, and welcome again to Pathway to Victory. Some of life's greatest joys are the relationships we cultivate throughout our lifetime, whether it's with a sibling, a spouse, a parent, or a friend. The people around us give us a sense of wholeness and well-being, which is why many Christians wonder if we will still know one another when we get to heaven, or if those memories have been erased from our minds. Well, stay with us because we're answering the question, will we know one another in heaven, on today's edition of Pathway to Victory. Growing old is not for the faint of heart. With age come aches, ailments, and sometimes a few extra pounds. The late humorist Irma Bombeck once wrote, "I'm not telling you what I weigh, but when I measure my girth and then step on the scales, I ought to be a 90-foot redwood." Unfortunately, most people don't age gracefully. Along with a few extra pounds come hearing loss, fading eyesight, aches, creaking joints. You know, part of growing older also means not always recognizing people. Have you ever had the experience of going to a high school or a college reunion? You look at people, you don't recognize them. If it wasn't for their name tag, you wouldn't know who they are. Even worse, they don't recognize you. And perhaps worse of all, have you ever stood in the mirror and looked at yourself and wondered, who is that person? Which all brings up an interesting question. And that is, when we get to heaven, what will our bodies be like? Will we know one another? Will other people know us? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. In our series, A Place Called Heaven, we're answering 10 of the most frequently asked questions in heaven. And today we're going to answer the question, will we know one another in heaven? Now, to answer that question, we first of all need to understand something about Jesus' promise of a resurrection body. In heaven, the Bible is very clear. We're not just going to be some spirit floating around. We are going to have a physical body. Now, that shouldn't be a surprise when you look at God's original plan for us. God's original design for us was both a spirit and a body. Look at Genesis 2:7 about God's original creation. "Then the Lord God formed man from the dust from the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being." God created us originally body and spirit. And that's why it should be no surprise that in eternity we will always exist in a body as well as be spirit. God's future plan for us includes a physical resurrection. Whenever we look at the Bible, we find that there are actually two resurrections that will occur. Did you know it's not only Christians who will receive a new body? Unbelievers will also receive a new body for eternity. A believer's body is necessary so that we can experience God's unending blessing. Unbelievers must receive a body so that they can experience God's everlasting judgment. But everybody is going to be raised from the dead. Everyone is going to have a resurrected body. The Bible talks about two resurrections. The resurrection for believers, for Christians, is called the first resurrection. In Revelation 20, verse 6, John says, "Blessed and holy is the one who has part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power. But they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. What is the first resurrection? The first resurrection, now get this, doesn't refer to a point in time. Instead, the first resurrection refers to that group of people, believers, who will receive a new body to experience God's blessing. Not every believer will receive his new body at the same point in history. Paul makes that clear in 1 Corinthians 15, 22 and 23. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all will be made alive, but each in his own order. Some people, some of us, will receive our resurrection body at the rapture. At the rapture, remember, the Lord himself will descend from heaven. And the dead in Christ, that is, those believers who have already died since the time of Pentecost, they will be raised. And then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. 1 Corinthians 15, 52 and 53 say, at that time, we will be changed and receive our new bodies. But then there'll be other people who will receive their new bodies at the second coming of Jesus, 7 years later after the tribulation. And then there's another group of believers who are saved during the millennium who will receive their new bodies at the end of the 1,000-year reign of Christ. But all of those people are part of the first resurrection, the resurrection of the righteous. In Daniel 12, 2, Daniel says, many of those who sleep in the dust of the ground will awake, believers to everlasting life, but others, the unbelievers, to disgrace and everlasting contempt. The first resurrection is the resurrection of the saved. But there is a second resurrection, and that is the resurrection of all the unsaved. There will be a time in the future when every unbeliever who's ever been born is going to be raised from the dead. Right now, when an unbeliever dies, he goes to Hades, the temporary place of the unsaved. But one day, they're going to be raised. And unlike the first resurrection that occurs in stages over a period of time, the second resurrection, the resurrection of unbelievers, all occurs at one point in history, immediately before the great white throne judgment. We find it described in Revelation 20, verses 13 and 14, the resurrection of the unsaved. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, everyone according to their deeds. Verse 14 says, and death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire, Gehenna. This is the second death, the lake of fire. The two resurrections, everyone, believers and unbelievers, will receive a new body for all eternity. Now that raises an interesting question. How is it possible that people whose bodies have died could have bodies that ever come to life again? How can something that has died ever come to life again? Actually, the Corinthian Christians had that very same question. Paul, we believe in a spiritual resurrection, but a literal physical resurrection, how can that be? In 1 Corinthians 15, 35, Paul anticipated that question. He said, but someone will say, how are the dead raised, and what kind of body do they come? What kind of body do they have? Have you ever thought about that? How is it that the dead are raised? How is a resurrection at all possible? Well, Paul answers that question by using an analogy, and that is of planting and harvesting. Look at 1 Corinthians 15, verses 36 to 38, where Paul explains how a resurrection happens. That which you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And that which you sow, you do not sow the body, which is to be, but a bare grain, perhaps of wheat or something else. But God gives it a body just as he wished, and to each of the seeds a body of its own. Think of planting and harvesting. What's involved in that? Well, first of all, when you plant a seed, that means the seed actually dies. If you plant a watermelon seed in the ground, that seed dies before it ever comes to life. And so it is with the resurrection. When we die, that death is necessary for there to be a future harvest. If you don't plant a seed and the seed dies, never will a harvest come months later. It's the same way with us, Paul says. Death is not only inevitable, it is necessary. It has to happen for us to ever inherit God's kingdom. Verse Corinthians 15, 36, that which you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And he explains why in verse 50, for flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit that which is imperishable. Think of it this way. Your body is perfectly designed for this world. But your body is totally not suitable for residence on Mars or Pluto or any other planet. Your body is only suitable for this planet. And it's the same way in terms of this earth and the new earth and the new heaven. Our bodies are designed for this earth, but they are totally inadequate for the new heaven and the new earth. And that's why Paul says, flesh and blood, that is what we have right now, cannot inherit the kingdom of God. And that's why it's necessary that we die first, that our bodies be placed in the ground, so to speak, planted so that something better can be harvested later. And that leads to the second part of the process, the reaping of the harvest. Notice something about the relationship between the planting and the harvest. First of all, the harvest is superior to the seed. What is harvested is always superior to the seed. For example, let's just imagine it's a hot day here in Dallas, Texas, in August, 110 degrees in the shade. You've been out working in the yard, you come in and you need some refreshment, and you've got a choice. You can either have a cold slice of watermelon or you can eat a watermelon seed. Now, which would you choose? The watermelon or the watermelon seed? I think everybody would choose the slice of watermelon because the harvest is always superior to the seed. It's the same way with the resurrection. What is harvested at the resurrection, our new body, is vastly superior to that which is planted. You know, it's important to understand that at the resurrection, it's not our old bodies that we are going to carry into heaven. And aren't you grateful for that? Aren't you grateful God doesn't just resurrect your old body and, you know, put some duct tape around it and some glue and try to hope it holds together for all eternity? No, it's not our old bodies. Our old bodies are raised, but then they are completely renovated. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And what we receive is much superior to what was planted. But secondly, the harvest is also similar to the seed. It's superior to the seed, but it's similar to the seed. I mean, you don't plant a watermelon seed and harvest a kumquat, okay? If you plant a watermelon seed, guess what? You get a watermelon. And it's the same way with us. When our bodies die, it's not someone else who is resurrected. We don't get a body that is totally dissimilar to what we were. Our new bodies are going to resemble our old bodies. We'll talk about that more in just a moment. But if you want a good idea of what your resurrection body is going to be like for eternity, the best place to look is to look at Jesus himself. Jesus is the prototype of our resurrection body. In 1 John 3, verse 2, the apostle writes, "Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be, but we know that when he, Jesus, appears, we shall be like him, because we will see him just as he is." The best answer to what we're going to be like in our new bodies is to look at the resurrection body of Jesus. Remember, after Jesus was raised from the dead, he spent 40 days on the earth ministering to people. So, let's ask the question, first of all, was Jesus' resurrection spiritual or physical? There were some in the Corinthian church who said, "Oh, we believe Jesus was raised from the dead, but we believe it was a spiritual resurrection. We can't believe that he was literally, physically raised from the dead." And so in verses 3 and 4, 1 Corinthians 15, Paul makes it clear that the physical resurrection of Jesus is the very essence of the gospel message. Paul wrote, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures." It was a physical resurrection. How do I know that? Well, just look at what happened to Jesus over those 40 days he was on the earth in his resurrection body. 17 different times he conversed with his disciples. On three occasions, he ate with his disciples. On two different occasions, he allowed his disciples to touch him. What was Jesus' resurrection body like? First of all, it was superior to his earthly body. Now, Jesus was without sin in his earthly body, but he had limitations just like you and I have in our earthly bodies. But in his resurrection body, he was vastly superior. For example, on several occasions, Jesus was able to materialize at a place at will. He was able to come through a door that was locked. He had abilities in his new body that he didn't have in his original body. But secondly, Jesus' body was also similar to his earthly body. If you look at the accounts of those 40 days Jesus spent on earth, you will discover that those who knew him best eventually recognized him. I say eventually because many times they didn't immediately recognize him. You say, well, why is that? Several reasons. Some were so full of sorrow, they couldn't see clearly. One appearance happened when it was still dark and they couldn't make out his features. On another occasion, the distance between Jesus and his disciples were great enough to obscure recognizable features. Some were disbelieving. They didn't believe he was really going to come back again. Others weren't expecting to see him at all. What is it that caused them to recognize Jesus? There was some similarity between Jesus' earthly body and his new body. Perhaps it was his stature. Perhaps it was the color of his eyes or his hair. But something about Jesus was recognizable. Well, that leads to the question, what will our bodies be like in heaven? Remember, John said, we shall be like him. Colossians 1:18 says that Jesus was the firstborn from the dead. That word firstborn is the Greek word prototokos. Prototokos. He is the prototokos, the prototype of those, all of us, who will be raised from the dead. So knowing that that is true, we can gather several important facts about our new bodies in heaven. First of all, our bodies will be physical. Just as Jesus had a physical body, so will we. Now, our new bodies will be vastly different than our original bodies. Make no mistake about it. In verses 39 to 41 of 1 Corinthians 15, Paul said, all flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one flesh of men and another flesh of beast and another flesh of birds and another flesh of fish. By the way, that verse just shoots to smithereens the theory of evolution, doesn't it? My evolution is based on the idea we all originate from the same flesh. Not so, God says. You're not an animal. You're different. God created you differently than he did the animals. Verse 40, there are also heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is one and the glory of the earthly is another. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, another glory of the stars, for stars differ from star in their glory. What's the point of all of that? Paul is saying, don't find it hard to believe that our new bodies would be different than our earthly bodies. God designs our bodies just like he does animals and fish and the stars and the moon, all to serve their unique purpose. Verses 42 to 44. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown a perishable body. It is raised an imperishable body. It is sown in dishonor, but it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Now notice the word body, soma in Greek, is repeated over and over again. That refers to a physical body. It's Paul's way of saying, don't miss this. We are a body, but on earth, in our current state, we are a natural body, but in the new heaven and new earth, we will be spiritual, but we will still be a body. Let me summarize for you, if I can, the differences between our earthly body and our heavenly body for the new heaven and new earth. First of all, our earthly bodies decay. Our heavenly bodies will endure. Secondly, our earthly bodies are infected with sin. Our heavenly bodies will be free of sin. Thirdly, our earthly bodies are weak. Our heavenly bodies will be powerful. And finally, our earthly bodies are for the old earth. Our heavenly bodies are for the new earth. Now, people have all kinds of questions about what we'll be able to do in our new bodies and what they will be like. The best way to answer those questions is to look at the body of Jesus. For example, we discover, number one, we will eat in our new bodies. Can I hear an amen on that? As we get closer to lunchtime, yes. We will eat in our new bodies. Remember when Jesus appeared before his disciples? You know, they were just so awestruck at seeing the risen Lord. You know, they wanted to pray and have a Bible study. Jesus said, hey, can somebody get me something to eat? I'm hungry. Give me something to eat. We'll be hungry in heaven and we'll have plenty to eat. Luke 22, verses 29 and 30, Jesus said, just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, I grant you that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. Secondly, we will wear clothes in heaven. That's one way. This isn't going to be like Eden, where we all walk around in nature's own like contestants on Survivor. It's not going to be that way on the new earth. We will actually have clothes in heaven. How do I know that? Well, the Bible describes Jesus as being clothed. Revelation 1:13, in his resurrection body, he was clothed in a robe reaching to his feet and girding across his chest was a golden sash. For Revelation 3:5 promises, he who overcomes will thus be clothed in white garments. In Revelation 19, the second coming of Christ, we the church are pictured as coming with Christ, and we the church will be dressed in fine linens, bright and clean. Thirdly, we will retain our sexual identities in heaven. There's no transgender in heaven. We will be male and female just as God created us. You say, how do you know that? Especially when you consider verses like Galatians 3:28 that says, in Christ there is neither male nor female. Some people point to that verse and say, well, there'll be no more gender in heaven. No, that verse is talking about right now, about our equality before God. In God's eyes right now, God makes no distinction in status before him between male and female. If you are in Christ, you are equal before your heavenly Father. He's not talking about the future. In the future, we will retain the genders by which God created us. How do I know that? I could point to a lot of evidence, but in Luke 24, verse 16, Jesus is with his disciples on the road to Emmaus. They didn't first recognize him. Look at Luke 24, verse 16. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. You say, well, how does that relate to gender? Well, obviously, when they were talking to Jesus, he appeared to be somebody else. He appeared to be just another man. He didn't appear as some otherworldly, sexless alien. They would have had a whole different conversation if that had been the case. But he looked like another man, another human being. And so it will be in our resurrection bodies. We will retain our gender. Secondly, our bodies will not only be physical, they will also be perfect. They will be perfect. No more cancer, no more heart attacks, no more strokes, no more high blood pressure. Revelation 21, verse 4 says, the first things will have passed away. Revelation 22, verse 3, and there shall no longer be any curse. Many of you know Johnny Erickson, my friend, a great woman of God, at age 17, through a diving accident, became a quadriplegic. Listen to what Johnny has to say about the promise of a new body. Can you imagine the hope this gives someone like me with a spinal cord injury, or someone who is cerebral palsied, brain injured, or has multiple sclerosis? Imagine the hope this gives someone who is a manic depressive. No other religion, no other philosophy promises new bodies, hearts, and minds. Only in the gospel of Christ do hurting people find such incredible hope. Isn't that great? That's the promise we have. Our bodies will be perfect. They'll be physical. They'll be perfect. Thirdly, our bodies will be personal. What I mean by that is, when you are raised from the dead, you don't become somebody else. You are still you. You know, in 1 John 3:2, John said, we shall be like him. We will be like Jesus. That doesn't mean we all become little mini-me's of Jesus, without any distinction. It means we will inherit the heavenly DNA like Jesus, but we still retain our own identities. How do I know that? Well, Luke 24:39, when Jesus appeared to his disciples, listen to what he said in his new resurrection body. See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. It is I. It's not somebody else. It is I. It means in heaven, we won't be someone else. You will be you. And the relationships, by the way, you have here on earth with Christians will continue in heaven. You'll know other people, they will know you, and you will enjoy perfect fellowship untainted by sin of any kind. Ron Rhodes, theologian, says it this way: our eternal reunion with Christian loved ones and friends will be ceaselessly glorious. Keep in mind that we will no longer have sin natures. There will be no fights among loved ones. There won't be any resentment or envy or jealousy. There won't be any one-upmanship or rivalries. There won't be any crosswords or misunderstandings or selfishness. Our relationships in heaven will be truly wonderful and utterly satisfying. Now that's something to look forward to in that place called heaven. As if we didn't already have enough to look forward to, the Bible's depiction of our heavenly body is truly wonderful. All of our aches and pains and diseases, both in the body and in the mind, will be erased, never to return again. Plus, the actual features of heaven will be far greater than anyone can imagine here on earth. Well, many Christians believe that heaven will be exactly the same for everyone, with a few minor adjustments. But as we'll discover next time, that's not the case. In fact, the kind of heaven we experience in the next life will be largely determined by how we conduct ourselves in this life. Stay tuned for a preview of what's coming up next in our series, A Place Called Heaven. The fact is, if we have placed our faith in Jesus Christ, we are all going to make it into the spiritual end zone, into heaven. Some who make it into heaven will be celebrated by God for the way they played the game. Other Christians will be evaluated by God for having done little to contribute to the success of the team.
Set your DVR and join us next time for part one of the message, Will Heaven Be the Same for Everyone? Here on Pathway to Victory.